Hey, Dr. C with you. So should you go on hormone replacement therapy? You know, on one hand, menopausal symptoms are real. They can be disruptive, even life-altering, and they can just ruin a lot of things. On the other hand, there's a valid concern about risks. Top of mind by far is breast cancer. So how do you weigh these big conflicting factors? I'll go through this with you in some detail, but here's a real quick overview if you want, like, just the bare things you need to know. Ultimately, this is a personal decision that you make, best and done with conversation with your prescriber. And the main considerations are that if you are a younger woman, say 40s or 50s, these symptoms are really bad, they don't respond to anything else, you have very low risks for heart disease or breast cancer or premature cognitive decline. In those cases, the use of hormone replacement therapy is a very reasonable decision. There are some good natural options readily available. The side effects are still real, but they're rather small for you, and the benefits are likely. 90% or more of women do see relief from symptoms. Now, on the opposite extreme, if you're a woman who's older, say 60s or 70s, and this is something to where you have risk factors as well, maybe a family history of breast cancer, maybe some risk factors of your own for heart disease. These are situations to where it would be much less indicated. So yeah, that's a general big once over. So what do we know now and why have things changed so much? Well, if we go back to pre-2002, most prior studies suggested that hormone therapy definitely would help most menopausal symptoms, but also there was various health benefits to it. This was when hormones were thought to improve cardiac health, and they were also thought to cut the risk of brain aging. And in many cases, women were put on hormone therapy not just because they had bad hot flashes or night sweats. They were put on it to help improve their health overall. It was done as a way to try to reduce some of these risks. In 2002, the Women's Health Initiative study was published, and the study brought a lot of new information to bear. Now, how it differed from prior studies was that the people were randomized. It wasn't just looking back at those who did hormones and compared them against those who didn't do hormones, but it actually took a large group of women and randomly had some do hormones and some take placebo. Now, the big difference is that people who self-selected to take hormones or not had a lot of other differences. Those that chose to take hormones, remember at the time, doctors told women that hormones were healthy, they were protective. And the women taking hormones were those that generally had more medical care. You know, they had more involved doctors. They were generally of a higher socioeconomic status, and they had fewer risk factors going into it. And so there was a question as to whether some of these benefits were because hormones were making women healthy or because healthy women were the ones taking hormones. So when the Women's Health Initiative study was done, it wanted to answer that question. And honestly, when it was done, it wasn't expecting to refute the existing ideas. It was really expecting to refine and find just how helpful hormones were. Maybe they weren't quite as much as was thought, but to what degree were they going to be helpful and protective? That's what they set out to answer. However, though, when women were randomly assigned, everything changed. They found that the healthy user bias was bigger than they thought, and that actually these health benefits largely eroded. So they looked at health outcomes in terms of control of menopausal symptoms, meaning systemic symptoms like hot flashes or night sweats. But then they also looked at various health outcomes. So cardiovascular disease risk, cognitive decline, cancer risk, bone health. These are some of the big outcomes that were tracked. And what they saw was that hormones didn't improve health risks. There was no large benefit. In fact, there was harm in terms of cardiovascular health and cancer risk that were quite marked. Now, the study can be broken down into four different segments. There was the younger women, 40s and 50s, older women, 60s and 70s, and there was women that had uteruses and those that did not. And women were given different medications based on whether or not they had a uterus. So the medications used were conjugated equine estrogen, which was under a trade name called Prempro. Conjugated means protein-bound, equine means horse-derived, and estrogen, well, pretty straightforward. There was also a compound called medroxyprogesterone acetate, or MPA. That was given to protect women that had uteruses so the uteruses would not become hypertrophied and develop uterine cancer. So basically you had these four groups, you know, younger and older, with and without uterus. And you got a sense of it seeing how things were different in the age groups, but also how estrogen worked alone or estrogen worked with progesterone. So some differences, they did see that the progesterone group actually had a lower risk of endometrial cancer than those on placebo. There were protective effects. They did see, though, that the cardiac risks were high regardless of their hormone combination. They also saw that the breast cancer risk was more pronounced in the women receiving the progestin as opposed to the estrogen only. So these were some relevant differences. Now, a lot of questions have come up since then. So there are many who are strong, passionate advocates of natural hormones. And they've looked at this and they've looked at the data in ways that they've embraced the good things, but shied away from the bad things. And I don't think you can do that. So they've on one hand said that hormones are good for helping symptoms and they're protective in certain ways based upon some of the older studies. And they've tried to then say that these studies on CEE and MPA, the good data about them can be applied to other hormone preparations. But then when things go bad, it's different. And then when things are bad, they say, oh no, that's because they were on different types of hormones. But you can't have both. You can't say that all hormones work the same for benefits and that hormones are different when it comes to the side effects. That's an issue there. So now most hormone preparations are plant derived and they're chemically identical to what the body makes. Now the chemically identical is more true for the progestin than it is true for the estrogen. And there's pretty strong consensus that it's better. It's definitely better to have hormones that are not different from what the human body makes. But you can't just say that you would then not have any complications. We know that in some ways the estrogen from the Women's Health Initiative study is actually weaker than the natural estrogens now broadly in use. The conjugated part of conjugated equine estradiol really made it inactive. That was a binding protein that neutralized a lot of its effects. So dose per dose, we know that pure versions of human estrogen work stronger. They have more effects. And it's most rational to say probably more effects good and more effects bad. Now, to be fair, there haven't been detailed studies done on the newer compounds. And we wish that would happen, but most who really follow this field don't expect that to happen. The time it would take and the funding it would take would be massive. And no one who would do that funding has high expectations that the results would be radically different. And then the other problem is that the time it would take to do a study like that, yeah, that could be another 10 to 15 years to get the results or even longer. The Women's Health Initiative took a full decade between when it was started and when the data came out. And by the time that passed, there could likely be different products in the market. So it's tough to invest a lot in research when by the time it comes out, it may no longer be relevant. So for that reason, we don't expect to see another big study like this one. Many have called this the final word in hormone replacement therapy. So what have we learned from that? What do we know now? Again, quick recap, cardiovascular disease is worse for those on hormone replacement therapy. Breast cancer risks are higher. And by heart disease, we're thinking about heart attack, congestive heart failure, stroke, pulmonary embolism. These are all things that are clear risks. Now, for some women, these risks are more identifiable than others. They've got a strong family history. They have genetic clotting issues. They have higher lipids. They've got higher blood pressure. These things make that more probable for them. And so too for breast cancer. Some are more clearly at risk than others due to body weight, family history, other considerations such as alcohol intake. These are all relevant factors for them. Now, in terms of numbers, this really is a few cases per thousand in younger women. So it's not that you take hormones and you will get cancer. No one should say that. And it's a reasonable consideration for younger women with low risk and bad symptoms. But when the risks are higher, it's something that a woman should be informed of and should be able to take into account and make her own best decision. A few other thoughts. So bone health has come up quite a bit too. And estrogen does help bone health. And it was shown that the younger women did have better bone health on replacement therapy than not. A couple of wrinkles, though. The duration of benefit is thought to be no longer than the duration of hormone usage. And if the women were to have stayed on hormones longer into their ages in which bone risk was really apparent, the concern is that the cumulative years would have made the overall side effects greater. And as it was, there was no net benefit for mortality. So if there was a way in which benefits to bone health outweighed detriments to cancer or heart disease risk, it didn't happen. And there's no reason to think it would happen if things had gone on longer. So ultimately, hormones are not considered a good strategy for maintaining bone health. A lot of other things are, but hormones are not due to their lack of net benefit. A couple of other final things to consider. There are vaginal symptoms women have: atrophic vaginitis, dryness, painful intercourse. Systemic, like whole body hormone replacement therapy, doesn't consistently help with vaginal symptoms. But there are topical therapies such as creams or lozenges that do a very good job doing that. They work locally, they act on the vaginal lining, and they don't spread hormones throughout the remainder of the body. And last point is skin health. Now, this was not looked at in the Women's Health Initiative, but it is known that systemic hormone therapy can improve skin health. There can be less fine lines, less wrinkling, healthier collagen levels because of that. Thankfully, now there are versions of estrogen that are safe, they're non-prescription, they work locally, but they don't work throughout the body. So they can maintain skin health without hormone replacement therapy. So overall, should you take hormones or not? It's your call. A lot of things can help: hot flashes and night sweats, dietary therapy. I talked about like a lot of recipes in the Hormone Healing Cookbook, lots of good foods that make a big difference. Reductions in alcohol, caffeine, you know, better exercise, simple things like that can help a lot, but not 100% and not for everyone. And also there are some to where those changes are not things they wish to pursue. So in those cases, hormone replacement therapy does often work. Not always. I have practiced quite a bit and used it extensively, and there are those that do not respond to it. This is not common, but somewhere around 5 to 7% of women with menopausal symptoms do not benefit from hormone replacement, no matter how much they take or how they take of it. But most do. So that's the main thing to consider. And the main cons are these risks. And certainly women can be more thorough about screening, more thorough about lowering related risk factors, but ultimately it is a personal decision. There's no simple answer that's easy across the board. The main point that I wish to convey, though, is please know that hormones don't create health benefits. That's pretty clear. So if you're taking them for health benefits, I would ask you to reconsider. If you do have bad symptoms and you're aware of the side effects and you worked around them, totally fine. But if you were taking them to help to lower some factors of aging, please reconsider. That data is no longer present. All right. Dr. C with you. Take great care. We'll talk again really soon. Bye-bye.